Another exciting night at Agape Chapel. I'm so glad that you're here to study God's Word, because that's what we love doing, is studying the Bible, learning about Jesus, growing in Him. And so if you have your Bible, what book are we in? Anybody remember? It's been like 2 weeks. The book of Jeremiah, here tonight. Chapter 30, if you could turn with me in the book of Jeremiah. The 30th and the 31st chapter of Jeremiah really are tied together. Unfortunately, we won't finish chapter 31. We might stick our toe in it a little bit here tonight. They deal with future events. And the 30th chapter of Jeremiah deals with the period known as the tribulation, the great tribulation. In chapter 31 deals with the kingdom age, the kingdom of God, and that will be established on the earth really at a time when the earth has been judged, in that marvelous kingdom period. The key sort of the two chapters are found in the last verse of chapter 30, where he declares in verse 24, the fierce anger of the Lord shall not return until he has done it. Until he performed the intent of his heart, then in the latter years or the latter days, you will consider it. These are prophecies of the last days. Of course, Daniel was writing prophecies in the 12th chapter of the book of Daniel. I want to read it to you, where Daniel was told to seal up these things that was spoken to him in verse number 9 of chapter 12. He says, "For seal them up until the time of the end." In other words, it isn't given to you, Daniel. It isn't given for you to understand yet. Just seal it up, for in the last days, knowledge shall be increased. Isn't that an interesting phrase? Well, you know, a lot of people think the knowledge is going to be increased because we can fly on jets now, and the internet knowledge and all that. But yes, I understand that in the last 50 years or the last 100 years, the things and inventions that everybody has created. But I really believe is the knowledge of the understanding of the Word of God when it deals with prophetic issues during the last times, how the knowledge is going to be understood. Peter tells us in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 12, he says, they wrote of things that they did not really understand themselves. Isn't that something? They were told to write, even as Daniel said, just seal up the book, Daniel. Don't worry about it. It's not for you. It's for us here tonight as we study God's word. A couple things about prophecy. Number one, when you don't really understand it until it's, you know, a lot of times in prophecy, you don't really understand the fulfill under meaning of it until it's complete, right? You know, a lot of it is somewhat you know and somewhat you don't know. And the other type, of course, is we really don't know until it's fully complete. And then many of the prophecies have a twofold understanding when you look at prophecy. And we'll get one tonight, definitely has one of those double fulfillment. So in chapter 30, these events have not yet happened. They will still yet future. Verse 1, so this is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, Thus speaketh the Lord God of Israel, saying, write these all the words that I've spoken unto thee in a book. So he's commanded to record these in a book that we're looking at right now. Isn't that pretty awesome that we're actually looking at the things Jeremiah had written down? For lo, the Lord said, the days come, says the Lord, that I will bring again the captivity of my people Israel and Judah, says the Lord, and I will cause them to return to the land that I gave to their fathers, and they shall possess it. Now, of course, this is, you know, you would think this is a prophecy concerning the regathering of the nation of Israel back into the land after the Babylonian captivity. That did happen after they went into Babylon. But this is really speaks about the final gathering of the Jews into the land. We're not quite yet seeing the final gathering, and I'll mention that reason why here in a moment, even though they're gathered into the land. It's interesting thing to me that God saw, we saw in our verse here, where it spoke about how Israel and Judah, you know, Israel and Judah are going to be gathered. Did you notice that? See, Israel and Judah, they hadn't been together for a long time. It wasn't very long after the death of Solomon since they were divided as the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. But yet we see that they'll be gathered together, the 10 tribes being the northern kingdom and the 2 tribes of the southern kingdom. The Jews, according to the scriptures, are going to be gathered into the land. We know what we're going to see, of course. They're going to be rebuild their temple under the leadership and the inspiration of the leadership of the Antichrist. As we studied Revelation, as we look at the prophecy, I've been over there before. Have you been to Israel? If you don't, get on a plane and go. And you're able to go up there on Temple Mount, and you can see exactly where this temple could fit even right now. And the man of peace is going to come in there and say, you know what, and Revelation speaks about this wall to separate the profane from the holy, basically for the Jews and the Gentiles. And you could see right there up on Temple Mount where they could build a wall, separate the two, and then the Jews could build their own temple. And so, you know, it's great. A lot of people think that that's going to be the end, but yet the Jews are going to be kicked out of the land again. Once the temple has been rebuilt, it talks about how the Antichrist will come into the temple. You know what he's going to do after 3.5 years? He's going to declare himself to be God and demand to be worship. And he says at that point, the eyes of the Jews will be open to this Antichrist. The Lord's word to them in Matthew chapter 24, he says, flee to the wilderness, and there you will be preserved for 3.5 years. So this is the next disbursement out of the Jews, out of the land. After this 3.5 years, they're off, they're going to go. They're going to be gone. And a lot of them are going to find places to hide because of the wrath of the Lamb that will come upon them. And so the prophecy in chapter 30, when it is complete, they'll never leave the land again. But it tells us in Revelation chapter 13, but they will flee from the land to the area that the Lord has prepared. And those that don't flee will experience the wrath of the Antichrist. And as he turns to make war with the remnant of the woman's seed, Revelation chapter 13. So the people that are gathering now, there's a lot of excitement, a lot of pressure, the building and rebuilding the temple for them to have it. But all this is part of what God's plan is, that once again, he will turn his eyes back to Israel and Judah. Notice verse 4. For these are the words that the Lord spoke concerning both Israel and Judah. For thus says the Lord, we have heard a voice of trembling, of fear, and not of peace. Now the prophecy concerning, this is the prophecy concerning the great tribulation. Ask now and see whether a man does travail with child. You know, no man has ever known the pain of a woman bearing a child, right? At least that's what my wife told me and other women have told me. And it's not a fun thing. He says, but then they say, and why then do I see every man with his hands on his loin is a woman in travail? Otherwise, it's going to be so bad. It's like a man that's having a baby. He's in such agony. And all the faces are turned into paleness. So he sees the agony and the anguish that's going on upon mankind during this period of the great tribulation. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 24, verse 21, it will be a time of great trouble, great tribulation, such as the world has never seen before, nor will ever see again. This world has gone through tremendous wars, tremendous devastation. We are praying for those in Hawaii even today, all that they're going through and things that they see. He says, but this is nothing compared to what was going on. Daniel says the same thing in chapter 12, he says, and he said, and that day is great, so there's none like it, it tells us here. Jeremiah claims the same thing. That's going to be a time in history where the judgment of the earth is going to experience this great tribulation. Nothing like it's ever seen before. What I would, maybe you might want a footnote to read along with this, that you should be following along in the book of Revelation, chapter 6 through 18, that it talks about this period of time that's going to come upon this earth, where the stars are going to come tumbling down, the mountains are going to be moving, the oceans and everything else, and God pours his wrath upon this earth. You know, a lot of people don't like the book of Revelation, because it says it's filled with gloom and doom. Well, I actually really like it, because I know I've read the, have you ever read the book of Revelation? It's pretty awesome, isn't it? When our King of Kings comes back and restores order the way he designed it. We're living in a world that's in rebellion against God. We're living in a world in disorder, but God wants to bring order to us. Tremendous devastation he speaks about. In verse 7, so alas, for that day is great, so there is none, and that none is like it. It is even the time of Jacob's trouble. That's Jeremiah's phrase for the great tribulation, a time of Jacob's trouble. It's interesting that Jacob will be saved out of it. There's a lot that will flee to the wilderness, and well, God will preserve for these 3.5 years, as we mentioned before in the book of Revelation. We know that God will seal 144,000 of them, and they will not be hurt by the plague. So God will divinely protect his people during this period. Verse 8, and it shall come to pass in that day, says the Lord of hosts, that I will break his yoke off from off his neck, and will burst or break your bonds. And the stranger shall no more serve himself of him, and they shall serve the Lord their God, and David their king, whom I have raised up unto them. In verse 9 now, of course, where it shifts gears now, really does go into the kingdom age, where God's going to be setting them free. No longer will they be cursed, really, from the world, even as you see where David's seed, Jesus Christ, is going to reign instead. Isn't that a marvelous thing, that finally our King of Kings will reign, the eternal reign of the seed of David? And, of course, we know that all this will be fulfilled through Jesus Christ. In verse 10, therefore fear thou not, O my servant Jacob, says the Lord, neither be dismayed, O old Israel, for lo, I saved thee from afar, and thy seed from the land of their captivity, and Jacob shall return, and shall be in rest, and be quiet, and none shall be make him afraid. You know, that's the reason why I say this is a future verse. You can't say that at the present day. Israel is not at rest and peace. There's strife, there's turmoil. You know, there's attempts to really bring down all of what God is doing there in Israel. If you watch the news, one of the great flashpoints in the world is this little itty-bitty country known as Israel. And the hotter it gets, the closer you get to Jerusalem, and how there's just a tremendous hatred all around them. Why? Because, I believe, because they claim to be part of Abraham's seed. They're simply Jews. And he says there's going to be a time of real peace, and a quietness won't happen till the Prince of Peace comes to rule upon this earth. You know, you too can't know the peace of God unless the Prince of Peace rules it within your heart. For I am with thee, says the Lord, to save thee. Isn't that a beautiful scripture, that I'm with thee? Romans chapter 11. Verse 25, we'll be getting this here in a few weeks on Thursday night. Paul tells us that blindness has happened to Israel in part until the fullness of the Gentiles comes in. We'll talk about that. What is the fullness of the Gentile when it comes in? But then all Israel shall be saved, for the Lord shall send a deliverer out of Zion, to turn the hearts of their children unto their Father. And of course, this will happen when Jesus Christ comes again. And it goes on, he says, and he will make an end of all nations whither I have scattered thee. An end of all nations. You ever think of that? I think about our big old building in New York City that gathers all the nations of the world, and they try to make policies for the world and all that, and they run around with so much knowledge and so much pride without honoring God. One day, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, he's going to make an end of the United States. He's going to make an end of Mexico, the Canadians and Europeans and everybody. And it's so beautiful. We'll be living and reigning underneath our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. How long, when will this happen? I can't tell you. Got you there, right? But I think it could be even from as close as 7 years from now. The Lord took us home tonight, the rapture of the church, well, that would kick in the calendar where all of us will be with the Lord for eternity, and then a millennial reign will start. So that tells me how urgent really my heart should be. As I mentioned before, we should be looking for that return of Jesus Christ, but also looking around how we can reach people, pray for people, encourage people. He goes on, but I will correct you in measure and will not leave you altogether unpunished. You're going to have to be punished for your sins. Isn't that something that he said? The Bible says, whatsoever a man soweth, so shall you reap. If you sow to the flesh, of the flesh you'll reap corruption. There's always a consequences to our sin. For thus says the Lord, your bruise is incurable, and thy wound is grievous, and there's none to plead your cause. They're going to be judged. They're going to go through this time of judgment. And surely the Jews that are, even to this present day. This interesting phrase, did you catch that last part? There's none to plead your cause. A parallel prophet to Jeremiah was Ezekiel. We mentioned before where Jeremiah was prophesying there in Jerusalem, Ezekiel, at the same time, he had already been taken captive. He's already there at Babylon. There's a lot of similar things that they were saying because God is speaking the same message through the prophets. There wasn't a confusing message. It was the same. It's interesting about Ezekiel prophecy as God speaks about the judgment that was going to come upon it. It really did come upon the nation. He says in Ezekiel chapter 22, verse 3, he says, I sought for a man among them who would stand in the gap and to fill in the head. But I found what? I found none. And here's Jeremiah saying that basically the same thing. The Lord said, I didn't find any to plead their cause. So what's the implication of the text? What's the application of the text? I believe one of the things that we see here is how God is saying, he's looking for people to intercede. Looking for people to pray. Maybe, starting a prayer list. Praying for our nation. I have here in my pocket, it was given to me by a brother to read over, headlines out of Las Vegas. They go, well, can anything good happen out of Las Vegas? And it says, and it talks about how last month, President Hopeful and former President Donald Trump held a rally at Fervent Calvary Chapel in Las Vegas. Do you think we need to be praying for our nation? And the thing God has impressed in my heart very much of late, that how necessary it is for us to raise up interceder. How you can intercede. Well, Terry, I want to be in a ministry. I don't know what to do. Well, this is a good place to start is by praying. We have other people involved in the mission works here at Agape Chapel. If you bump into them and to ask them, how can I pray for them? Pray for you. We got Rob. We got all kinds of different people that are doing mission work that need prayer because we can't do it without prayer. because I think the nation is the same kind of, our nation's in the same kind of critical position that Israel and Judah were in before they went into captivity. Don't you think that same thing, same condition exists now? You know, what we saw in Israel and Judah at that time, they were careless for the things of God. You know, they were kind of flippant about the things of God. Yeah, I'm a Christian, but I want to party. I want to do my own thing. I want to, you know, Christianity has shifted its meaning of what Jesus said. Real Christianity, first of all, needs to be what? They need to be born again. They need to be born of the Spirit. We find them drawn after the pleasures of the world and forsaken the Lord. We're living in a pleasure media society, you know, and God is looking that there was none to plead their cause. And how tragic, you know, you think that maybe the judgment of God might have been put off for a while, maybe held back if people were willing to stand in the gap. I hope that you're challenged by that. I'm challenged by this verse that I would be one. And all it takes is a handful of people that make a difference. And I got proof of it. Because God in the book of Acts used a handful of individuals that took a world that was upside down and turned it right for the gospel of Jesus Christ. As you go on in verse 13, thou hast no healing medicine. They have no one to plead their cause, to bind them up. They have no healing medicines. And all your lovers had forgotten you. Yep, they hit the street. They don't seek you, for I wounded you with the wound of an enemy, with the chastisement of a cruel one. For the multitude of thy iniquity, and because of thy sins were increased. So the Lord then asked, why do you cry for your affliction? Your sorrow is incurable for the multitudes of your iniquity. Because of your sins were increased, I have done these things unto you. They're crying out because of the terrible things that they're experiencing during the Babylonian captivity. You know, don't think that being in Babylon was a piece of cake. For the most part, they were all taken away. In fact, it tells us that history tells us the Chaldeans and the Babylonians, when they would take somebody captive, you know what they would do? They would put a hook in your jaw. You ever think about that? Put a hook right through your jaw, through that, and they would lead you out. I go, oh, you know, some things, I was talking this morning, some things I can't imagine ever being around a bunch of snakes as we're talking about there in Exodus here this morning, or a hook around my jaw. But yet they felt it, and they knew it. As you go on in verse 16, therefore all those that devour you shall be devoured. God said, I'm going to destroy the nation that destroys you. Notice that all those who, they're going to be destroyed. So those that devour you shall be devoured in the great tribulation again as we jump into it. And all your adversaries, every one of them shall go into captivity. And they that spoil you shall be spoiled. And they that prey upon you will I give for a prey. And I will restore health unto you. And I will heal you of your wounds, says the Lord, because they called thee an outcast, saying, this is Zion whom no man seeketh after. You know, there really is Mount Zion. It's still sitting there today. Is it what he's representing? And I think most of you know that I'm involved with this TV network called His Channel. And one of the things that we did here the past few months, we sent the camera crew over to Jerusalem, and we rented the roof of the International House of Prayer, and we put cameras right there at the wall, and where you could watch it 24 hours a day, what's going on there in Jerusalem. And you know what? I finally saw, I says, I know exactly what I see on that camera. I see Mount Zion. Isn't that something that we have that where you could see it? He says, but no man seeks after the Lord. He says, thus says the Lord, behold, I will bring again the captivity of Jacob's tent, and I will have mercy upon his dwelling place, and the city shall be built upon her own heap, and a palace shall remain after their own manner, and out of them shall proceed thanksgiving and the voice of them that make merry, and I will multiply them, and they shall not be a few. I will also glorify them, and they shall not be small." So the dark days are coming, yes, because of your sin, because of your rebellion against the God. But by, beyond those dark days, he says there's going to be a glorious day. He says God will heal them and restore. I think about the mercies of God. You know, how many times in your life did you feel like, well, if I was God, I would throw in the towel on my life, right? Because of the mistakes that we made. But his mercies are everlasting. He doesn't give up on us. And again, in Israel, the voice of thanksgiving, the voice of praise, it tells us, and merriment as God will multiply them. In verse 20, he says, "And their children also shall be as before time, and their congregation shall be established before me, and I will punish those that oppress them." God said, of course, in Genesis chapter 22, verse 17, "In blessing I will bless thee, and bless those that bless thee, and I will curse those that curse thee." It's a promise that he made from Abraham is still true to this day. God's not a man that he should lie. He made that commitment. And there's a lot of anti-Semitism in the world that has been really creeping up in the world. And it's a dangerous thing, I really believe, that has really crept into the churches, where they're not supportive of Israel. They're not supportive of what God is doing. And really, maybe you heard this one before, that the church seeks to identify themselves as Israel themselves. If you run around across a church like that, that's extremely dangerous. Go exit stage left, get out of there. Because one thing that you'll discover, if they're wrong in one area, they're going to be wrong in many, many other areas. You cannot be blessed of God and opposed to people of God. Let me say that again. You cannot be blessed of God and be opposed to the people of God. Were the Jews perfect? We got a history of it in the Old Testament, don't we? But yet, let's let God take care of their problems, not us. Let's pray for the peace of Jerusalem and do what the scripture tells us to do. In verse 21, he says, "Their nobles shall be of themselves, the nobles shall be of themselves, and their governor shall proceed from the midst of them, and I will cause him to draw near, and he shall approach unto me. For who is this that engage his heart to approach unto me, says the Lord, and God's declaration, and you shall be my people." Isn't that something to go into the presence of the Lord? Remember the first time Moses ran into him? Up there in that burning bush, what was he doing? He had to say, "Take that shoes off, Moses, because, you know, you're entering into the holiness of God." But yet he says, who shall be my people, and I will be your God? Behold, the whirlwind of the Lord. Now, as far as the world is concerned, the whirlwind of the Lord, the great tribulation, goes forth with fury and continues with whirlwind. It should fall with pain upon the head of the wicked. I think this is an important verse, what we see, because there are those that like to say that Christians go through this period of tribulation. I'm talking about born again Christians. He says it shall fall with pain upon the head of the wicked. Yes, we do have sin in our lives. But the way God sees you, he sees you clean. He sees you right. Where are you going to be when all this is going on? We're going to be in heaven. I believe at what is called the marriage supper of the Lamb. There's those who would think that we're doing something else, but who knows? God has appointed us, then God has not appointed you to wrath. Jesus said, "Pray always that you escape these things, the great tribulation that's coming upon the earth, that you might be standing upon the Son of Man." That blessed hope that God has us. God has not appointed you to wrath. if you're feeling wrath this day, if you're feeling judgment this day, like I said the other day, it doesn't come from God. He's for you, and he's not against you. He wants to help you. He wants to strengthen you. He says, the fierce anger of the Lord shall not return until he has done it, until he has performed the intents of his heart. The intent of his heart, really, as we saw in this chapter, is to judge this God rejecting blasphemous world. It says, Jeremiah says, in the latter days you will consider it. These things in the last days, we should consider it, because the time that we're living in, I think that if I had an hourglass right here, you know, I would say the sundial the sand would be almost done. How about you? We're almost out of time. And so chapter 31, as you move forward, now he will speak about this glorious reign of Christ after the great tribulation. Aren't you always glad for some good news? So I thought we'd jump into it for a little bit. We're not going to take the whole chapter. So he tells us in verse 1, so at the same time, says the Lord, that is when the earth has been judged, as you're reading chapter 30, in God's wrath will really devour his adversaries. At the same time, says the Lord, will I be the God of families, of the families of Israel, and they shall be my people. Thus says the Lord, the people which were left on the sword found grace in the wilderness, even Israel, when I went to cause him to rest. The Lord has appeared of old unto me, saying, yea, I have loved thee with what? An everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness I have drawn you. What a beautiful, powerful verse, isn't it? God declares his love for Israel. He loved them with an everlasting love, even as we mentioned earlier. They've been disobedient. They've been rebellious. But God didn't give up on them. He loved them. Maybe that's a word for some of us that are dealing with some people that maybe have lost their way. They're not very lovable. But help us to love them the way God loves them, with this everlasting love. God loves us with this everlasting love, of course, with your life here today. You know, and I love what Jesus said, no man knows the Father except the Son, whom the Father has sent, and to him to whom the Son will reveal. He speaks about you now being able to come to him as he draws you into this beautiful love relationship, as God speaks to you even this night with this everlasting love. As you go on now in verse 4, now again the Lord says, again will I build thee, and thou shalt be built, O virgin of Israel. Thou shalt again be adorned with the tambourine, and will go forth and dance of them that make merry, and you shall be yet plant vines in the mountains of Samaria. And the mountains of Samaria is this West Bank territory. Maybe you've heard of it over the years. He says they're going to plant it once again. And he goes, and the planters shall plant and shall eat them as common things, for they shall be a day that the watchmen upon the Mount Ephraim, and that is also the West Bank territory up there on Mount Ephraim, and they should cry, and they will arise, say, arise, and let us go up to Zion unto the Lord our God. So Jesus Christ is coming again. And I love it. It says, speaks about Zion, as I mentioned before. Because you look at Mount Zion, it doesn't really look like much today if you travel over there. There's some hotels around and different things like that. But know this, one day our great God and Savior is going to set up headquarters right there on Mount Zion. It says, for thus says the Lord, sing with gladness for Jacob, and shout among the chief of the nations. Publish it, praise ye, and say, O Lord, save thy people and the remembrance of Israel. Thus pray for their salvation. You know, it really what he's saying here. Behold, I will bring them out from the north country and gather them from the coasts of the earth. Of course, the north country, where's the north country? You go straight up out of Israel, we know that as being what? Russia, up there. And, you know, Russia's having a really kind of rough time, even though they kind of, you know, like they're supposed to be have their act together. They're still having their economical troubles over there. You know, their shortages that they have. A few years ago, probably about 10 years ago, well, it takes you back a little bit, Time magazine wrote about the Jews there in Russia and how Russia was blaming the Jews for all their shortages that they have because of their exile and the problems that they have. They went back in the land. Even as Hitler, you know, Hitler blamed the Jews for his economic woes there in Germany. Isn't that something? And this big attempt to exterminate the Jews. The same kind of feeling is rising all around Israel. All the nations are there looking like, how can we defeat this country? How can we come against them? Not only for their, I think it goes beyond just their oil fields. I think it's a downright hatred for the Jews. They go all the way back to Abraham. In verse 7, and he said, gather them from the north country and from the coasts of the earth, and with them that the blind and the lame and the women with child and her that travails with child together, a great company shall return thither. This is a very, very interesting verse, especially with our history a few years ago, where the Jews point to the scripture that happened. There was this king over in Ethiopia, or this president, Salazar's or Salazis. You know, maybe you saw him in the news 10, 12 years ago, 15 years ago. In Ethiopia, there was many, many Jews, and they created such heavy persecution upon the Jews in that country that all of a sudden the Jews had this idea, let's gather together and let's go get them. And so they down there in a lot, there's an airport there, and they gathered up these 747s, and I like these guys, and they took all the seats out of the 747s. They flew down to Ethiopia. And it tells us within a 48-hour period, they brought some 14,000 Jews back to Israel. And then this mass exodus of these Jews out of Ethiopia, and each 747 carried about 1,200 people, so you can do the math to figure out how many trips that they took. So, but the thing that's interesting on that flight, they said that there was 14 babies that were born on that flight over, 14 babies. The reason why I bring that up, and we'll close here tonight, did you notice the end of verse 8? It says that women with child and her that travails with child together, a great company shall return thither. 14,000 came back, and they were having babies on board. And so they see this, the Jews see this fulfillment of what God did. Who knows? But it's very interesting. Next week, read ahead as we finish up chapter 31, and we'll probably venture into 32 if you guys can hang in there. I'm trying to get you back where we can go a little bit longer on Sunday nights. You know, you get me going, I can go a couple hours. I'm not there yet, so I won't do that to you. But so let's give thanks for that. Ray's going to come and close us in a song, but let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you. As we read these things and we just scratched at the surface of all that it had to say there, but really tells me that time is short. As even as Jesus said, look up for your redemption, draweth nigh. Help us to live that this week. Live that you could return at any moment. That our hearts would be for the gospel. Reaching our loved ones and those who don't know you. Lord, we just have opportunities that set before us, Lord, and help us to put our hands to the plow and not to look back. The world has nothing to offer. Lord, we also want to pray this night for our loved ones and our family that are sick, who aren't with us, Lord, that you might touch and heal, that we might hear the miraculous, the good work of Jesus Christ. And I just pray that if anybody came in here discouraged here tonight, they might sense that fresh work of the Holy Spirit in their hearts, that they too might leave knowing that God is for them and not against them. We just love you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Why don't we all stand?